Hey guys, welcome to another Minisode. Today we're going to be recording our pet peeves in romance.
Yeah.
We're so excited about this episode. This is going to be like a very fun episode. Yeah. What I want to definitely make clear that these pet peeves, though it's something that definitely kind of like takes me out the romance and I'm just like, ah,
yeah,
it doesn't ruin it the book for me.
Yeah, because like, sometimes you have books that you still give like 4 and 5 stars,
yeah,
even though it has one of your
there's
pet peeves
one
in it.
Right off the bat. The Deal, actually by L. Kennedy, which is like my five-star, like favorite of the faves,
one of my favorites,
has a pet peeve of mine in there. It doesn't ruin it for me. Sometimes if it's like a lot of pet peeves and the book is a cliche, then it'll
ruin
it. And
I'm going to admit to committing some of these pet peeve crimes.
Right, in your own writing.
Yes.
Yeah. So this is just going to be fun, a general thing of like, what just sits
don't
on our nerves
that.
And just like,
you know,
pokes
it, though,
it.
It's so funny because since we talk about pet peeves, now I'm like, oh my God, I can't do that. Jessen will be like all over me if I write that in here. Oh, change
you have
that.
Like a little voice inside
yes,
your head
it's
being
called
like,
Jessen.
This is one of Jessen's pet peeves. I cannot
I can't
write
do it.
This.
She'll kill me.
Okay, so guys, we're going to start with our pet peeves. Julia is going to start us off with one of hers. And most
yes.
of these, we share the same pet peeves. We're
right.
just going to, you know,
we're just gonna
go back
throw
and
them out
forth.
There and
back
talk.
And forth.
Yeah, so one, and this is one that's actually really come to me very recently, and that is misbranding romance books.
I think that to
genres.
Me, I noticed it more recently than any
yes.
other time
and
that I've ever been a reader.
Because we've been talking about this specific one, like recently there's a trend in branding books as rom-coms when they're
yes.
not. I don't know if you've noticed the very pretty, cute illustrated covers
which
that are out
the illustrated
there.
Cover trend,
they're,
I'm like, I'm so here for
yes,
it. There's such
adorable.
Cute covers. I
and
love
it's,
it.
It's different. I love when people kind of go outside the norm, you know?
Yeah.
However, you and I both have been reading a couple of books that are saying the rom-coms with the branding.
With like an actual tagline on the book. Like it says a rom-com, a romantic comedy.
Yes.
It does say it
on
the
Amazon.
Book. Like it's not just like, oh, we're just masquerading. It's like it actually says it like this is a romantic comedy.
And for me as a reader, it is so disappointing to think I'm diving into a, like a Penny Reed-esque book and I find it's loaded with angst and heavy issues.
Right. Which we've talked about this, about we don't mind reading angst right now.
Yes,
we prefer the lighter books.
Yeah.
But we don't mind reading angst, but I also have to be in the mood to read like one that's going to like kill me with my emotions.
Right. And I don't want to be tricked by the publisher so they can sell me a book. It just kind of irritates me. And I know a lot of this is beyond some author's
absolutely control.
Because if they're with a trade publisher, then obviously they cannot, you know, they don't have a lot of say so.
Yeah.
You know, so that's one thing that's just really kind of like grating my nerves.
Right. And exactly.
Lately.
We had talked about it. Like just because characters say some one-liners doesn't exactly categorize it as rom-com.
Yeah,
like I feel like the book at least has to have some situational comedy in it.
Yes.
And the plot line has to be a little bit lighter. Not saying you can't deal with heavy issues in a rom-com, but I think that
absolutely.
The overall feel of the book has to be a lighter feel.
Yes.
To be labeled
the
rom-com.
Overall, the humor has to be much more consistent.
Mm-hmm.
There aren't any seriously, seriously heavy issues. But I mean, y'all, I write paranormal tends to be on the darker, edgier side. And yes, there is humor between characters, but I would never label that rom-com.
Right.
You know?
So yeah, so that is one of our pet peeves, just misbranding rom-coms.
Okay, so what's one for you, Jess?
Okay, one of mine is character over description. And in the same feeling that it's like an info dump of their character description, that it's like, okay, let's pause all motion of the characters and let's focus on describing his hair color and his or her, because it happens both with guys and
girls. Yeah, it's like a full paragraph.
Oh, yeah. It's like hair color, eye color, eyebrow shape, skin tone, muscle build, height, what they're wearing. Like sometimes we don't need to know exactly what they're wearing.
Well, and sometimes,
like
we don't.
Like a general description, like a suit, we do not have to always pinpoint exactly what the character
wears. It's better to be
wears.
Sprinkled.
And
you know?
I mean, like some authors do it so well whenever we get like a general like impression. And then later on throughout the conversation, the character who is observing the other character will then notice an eye color. Will then later notice, oh, he like grabbed something and now we notice his muscles or whatever. It doesn't all happen like the second you see this person. You know what I'm saying? So that's just one of my, another over description that I find so funny. One novel I read one time, I don't like it whenever characters are compared to real life like celebrities. Mm-hmm. And I read a book one time that said that this character was a mashup of Denzel Washington, The Rock, and Jason Momoa. And I was just like, okay, well now I need to pause and try to figure out how all of these features come together. Huh. I'm like, okay, now I'm like, what parts are we taking from each of these?
I know.
Like, they're all handsome guys. You couldn't just pick one. You had to pick all three of these really
I laugh every time I read a book now and they list a celebrity. I'm like, oh, Jessen,
I'm like, no, I don't want to look alike.
Yeah, stop it. And I actually, and I don't know that I'm guilty of this one, but I make sure I never use a celebrity because, like, Jessen would be all over me, you know, like, what the hell, Juliette?
Because I just think, I mean, this is a completely personal preference and these are completely personal pet peeves, but yes. I just think I don't want to be picturing a celebrity. It's nice to be like, oh, this celebrity might fit this description.
I like when they just describe them in general and then we can picture them how, mm-hmm. you know, we fill in the blanks.
It's like, me the structure,
give me the dark hair, decorate. The chiseled jaw or whatever, yes, and let me do the rest of the decoration.
Yes, I like to decorate my men and women. Okay, so what's another one of yours, Juliette?
Okay, let's see. Another one of mine is when the heroines are, as we say, TSTL, too stupid to live. Yeah. Okay, when the heroines start making these unbelievable, ridiculous decisions, it just checks me out of the story. So,
right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we're not naming books, but there was this one book where the heroine was, and this wasn't necessarily like too stupid to live. It was just like so unrealistic. I couldn't even relate to her.
Right.
But she was a widow and she did not know the entire time she was married to this man for a long time that he was a gazillionaire. He had like tons and tons of money. And she lived outside the city and her friend was like, well, it's time for you to live inside the city. So she's like, well, I'm going to go and get this exclusive condo or whatever. And it was the rent was $25,000 a month. And I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, I was like, $25,000 a month? Why? What would you do? Like me, I'm like, give me that money. I'll help you spend that more economically.
I'll help you.
And her reasoning was she just wanted to be in the city and live this high life or whatever. I was like, okay, cool. I'm down with it. Well, then she didn't quite understand that the guy that was surrounded, that looked very Italian, that was surrounded by these very goon-esque thugs with guns in helping a guy that was bloodied into the back elevator, she still couldn't figure out that he was like
a mobster.
Yeah, a mobster.
Just like your regular neighbor. Home.
And she was just like making eyes at him as he got in the elevator. Oh, he's so hot.
But then
like,
whenever she finds out what he's doing, it's like completely a surprise.
It was so shocking. Like, right. I think I might have stopped before she figured it out. Oh, like I figured it out. Bad. And I was just like.
Yeah, I do not like whenever to further the story, the heroine has to be clueless.
Yeah.
But we're also trying to, or the author's trying to convey that this heroine is like very smart, very learned, very observant. But then all of a sudden they're not in situations because it furthers the plot.
Yes.
I think that's what I don't like. I don't mind a naive heroine at all. I just don't like whenever it doesn't make sense for you to be that gullible, that blinded to not notice something that to the reader is insanely obvious, and especially whenever it carries on throughout the entire novel.
And in direct connection to the too stupid to live character is the character that is completely unrelatable. And by that, I mean, I'm not talking about, you know, she's from a different culture and everything else. And, or, you know, like I think of Stella Lane, who is completely relatable to
me.
I empathized with her. I felt the feeling she was feeling. I could completely, you know, was connected to her, even though I do not have autism.
Yeah.
You know, I do not have that experience.
Right.
And so I think there are ways that even if you don't have the personal experience of a heroine, they can still be relatable to you.
Absolutely.
And so that's
you
one
want
of mine.
Your heroines to be accessible, unique and accessible.
Yes.
I like that. Okay, another one of my pet peeves are women that are inept at makeup because they never cared about it before. Like, I really have read a novel one time and the heroine's getting all gussied up for the hero.
Yeah.
And she usually doesn't wear makeup, which I'm all for heroines who don't care about makeup.
Right.
Like, if you want to be completely natural, like, go for it. Honestly, I love this trend. I feel like in recent years, this has been like the no makeup trend has been like super on. Mm-hmm. And like my sister goes to school with like zero makeup.
Yeah, so
and like
Noelle.
they're not made up at all. But whenever I was in high school, makeup was the thing. Like everybody wore full face of makeup to go.
My mom still to this day is, you know, well, don't leave the house without your lipstick on. No. You know, I don't think that's a Southern thing.
So I do really like the natural bare face look. Like I love that. But I read a book one time where the heroine is getting ready for a date with the hero, and she's never cared about this stuff before, but she all of a sudden wants to get made up, and she mm-hmm. couldn't figure out how to do mascara. And I'm just like, I don't understand how, like, she literally, she's like, I don't understand how this works. And I'm just like, I don't understand, because
I don't understand how you don't understand.
Even if you've never put it on by yourself, there's a gazillion commercials on TV.
Yeah, like you said, those tutorials on YouTube.
I understand if you'd have to go slow, but she was puzzled by how it worked.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't understand.
So that might be in the TSDL category
for
me.
I just don't understand. Or like, oh God, I hate. Okay, this is another one kind of just related in the makeup category.
Yeah.
I don't like whenever authors over describe makeup, because there are trends in makeup. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
And I remember reading a book that wasn't published recently, and the heroine was wearing blue eyeshadow and like red lipstick. And to me, those are like very clashing. And I'm just like, that doesn't sound great.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Blue? And I rather just like I love lipstick colors, lipstick mm-hmm. colors. You can, I mean, there's trends with that, but I think you're safer just like really describing
like our
lipstick.
Lucy,
but I really don't need a whole general description of the heroine actually saying, I put white eyeshadow in the inner corner, and then a smoky and then I did my sparkle purple eyeliner. Like, I don't need all that. I really don't. I really, really,
God,
really, really
me.
Don't.
Like, she's giving us a tutorial through the book.
No, I'm sorry. I'm just like, can we get to the important part, like the date?
Oh,
like,
my God.
Can we get her with other people?
And did he go, wow, look at your purple sparkly eyeshadow. You're so hot. I want you.
Yeah, exactly. So, yep.
Oh my God, that one's killing me.
I know. Okay, anyway. What's your next
one? So, this is one that actually probably irritates me more than anything. It's when the heroine is ultra, ultra beautiful, but she has no idea. She's utterly clueless that she is beautiful.
Like, she's totally irresistible to guys, but she's like, I don't understand why they all like me.
She is so sexy. Her face is like stunning, but she mm-hmm. has no clue. That is fucking ridiculous. Okay. I am sorry. It is far too unrealistic to me to be so utterly clueless that you are beautiful. I appreciate humility, and I even appreciate body dysmorphia.
Yeah.
You know, that I get.
If you're going to go in that direction.
If that is what this is about, mm-hmm. I understand that, you know, for certain characters who have this issue. But a woman who has been beautiful since birth would know it. I am sorry. She has had people telling her she's beautiful her
right.
entire
and
life.
And I think that this is more, I find that we have more confident heroines. Like, I feel like this is like a trend.
Yeah.
Like, more body confident, because it's like, you want to read about characters who are not down on themselves.
Right.
You know? And I feel like this is a trend in romance that's definitely been happening. I know that we've seen an influx in curvier heroines, and I really completely appreciate that.
Hello.
And I really appreciate whenever there are curvier heroines who love their bodies.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Who are not disappointed in the way that they look.
Because I know even, and I
and
don't
you know what?
If
sometimes you can look in the mirror and be like, damn, I look good today. That is completely fine. Like,
right.
You don't have to be like, oh, but I'm not beautiful. I'm like, you can think you're pretty.
I look,
it's okay.
You can think you're pretty. And honestly, you can be really beautiful and also have humility mm-hmm. and be humble.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? Like, I appreciate that very much.
Absolutely.
I don't want a character. I don't want a heroine who's going to be like, yes, I know I'm all that. And is like flipping her golden locks and all that shit. Like,
yeah, no.
That's not what I
mean.
What I mean is a girl who is she's just gifted with that. That is one of her gifts. Is
just
beauty.
Recognize what
and she
got.
Right.
And don't
and she
act
walks
like
in the room
don't
and is
know.
Like, why are they all staring at me? How can they, what are they looking at? Is there something on my teeth? Or like, you know, like, please.
Okay, can we just bring this up? Y'all know we love Twilight. We give it this props. But I think of Bella Swan whenever I think of the character who doesn't know how incredibly beautiful they are.
Yes.
But yet every male character in this book has a crush on
them.
Yeah,
they all want
But they're
her.
Just like, Of course not. Like, nobody likes me.
I'm so emo. I'm stay over here in my corner. Where are they staring? Stop it. As much as guys, we dog it, and then we love rewatching it.
We still love watching it, but I mean, there's just
but it's so true. Speaking of Bella, that is also one of yours. Do you want to skip to that one?
Which one?
Clumsy.
Oh, God, yes. Okay, so this one, I don't like clumsiness in a hair. And guys, if you see a trend with me, I'm much more harsh on my heroines than I am on my heroes.
Yes,
this is a trend.
Too.
And it's because I put myself in the, in their place.
I'm looking through here, and I don't think we have one pet peeve for a hero.
Yeah, we do.
We do?
Yeah. Okay,
we'll talk about it. We'll
anyway,
get there.
So the Bella-related pet peeve that I'm going to skip to right now is clumsiness being the big character flaw in a woman. And I'm talking about she is perfect in every single way, but she's clumsy. And I'm just like, oh my God, what a horrible character flaw. Oh my God, she's clumsy? Yeah. How will we ever survive?
She's tripping on air again.
I'm like, but everything else she does is fucking perfect. She says the perfect thing. She's never in the wrong, but she's fucking clumsy. Yes. And I'm just like, that's not a character flaw.
Yes.
That is not a character flaw.
Okay, so I'm going to admit this.
Look, let's get more writers. Writers. I'm getting a little. Writers. Can we like make there be a reason why the heroine is clumsy? Yeah. And I'm not talking about because she's never worn 5 fucking inch stiletto heels. I'm talking about, does she have a vertigo issue?
Yes,
like
yeah.
That could be something.
That could be
Does she have an inner
issue.
Ear problem that
yes.
makes her fall?
Yeah.
Like give her a reason.
Yeah.
Give her a reason.
Yeah.
Okay?
And so I'm going to totally admit
like
that
if she's
I
tripping
was
on
actually,
thin air.
Okay.
I'm just like, what are you tripping on? What the fuck are you tripping
trip on?
On
a root or something when she and her the guy were walking and, and you were talking about this. I'm like, okay, maybe she shouldn't be tripping because Jessen's going to fucking annihilate me. But she tripped on a tree root, you know? And I'm
I
like,
think
oh
that
my
there
God.
Are believable situations. I think
books.
There are believable situations where a heroine can experience falling. I'm saying if it is like... a common thing that this character does. And I'm
just
like,
constantly
stop. And the
Bella
reason
Swan.
The reason why she trips is to fall into the arms of the hero.
Exactly.
And I'm just like, no, there's so many ways that we can get proximity without making her
protect
fucking
her
clumsy.
From walking.
God. Put you in one of those fucking bubbles and just like a marshmallow
bubble,
man.
A bubble
like,
heroine.
We can't take you out anywhere, Karen.
I'll kiss you through
okay.
the plastic. Unzip the plastic bubble so I can come inside with you.
So anyway,
Sorry, we went way off for a second there.
We did. It's just, I'm just like, that's not a character flaw. That's something that just happens. And
it's like, the thing is, it is the least unattractive, you know, like it's most.
It's like, oh, I don't want
my heroine.
It's a flaw
that's not unattractive.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
I don't want my heroine to be perfect. Let's make her clumsy. And I'm just like,
right.
no, make her more imperfect.
Yeah.
I want
make
a
her
human
snort
being.
Laugh or something.
I want a human
know?
Being, you know, that has actual real problems besides not being able to walk.
It's so hard.
Sorry. Sorry.
Oh my God, you kill
Moving
me. Okay,
on.
So I've actually said my three main ones, so I'm just going to ride the coattails of Jessen.
Let's be real. I, on past minisodes where we've had to like rank stuff or whatever, I've given us each a 5-thing limit.
Yeah.
And whenever I was going into our Google Docs and I was looking and Juliette only had 3 and I was like, well, I'm going to take the rest of her blank ones, obviously.
What
so
the
I
shit?
I cheated and
she
I have
went
a
to
lot
town.
More.
All right, so let's hear another one.
One of my other pet peeves are the main character, whether it be the hero or the heroine, swearing off ever loving again because one douche nozzle burned them in the past.
Yes, I totally agree
I'm
with
like,
this one.
And I'm talking about like, I will never love again.
Yes.
So I'm going to be a player and I'm just going to sleep around and I know that I will never
find
love.
He broke my heart.
But then,
I'm never taking a chance again.
It's like as a reader, I'm like, but I'm reading a romance novel. So I already know that that's not true.
Yeah, this is going to be an HEA, guys.
Like,
spoiler.
Look, I'm not saying I'm reading a book at this very moment that one of the characters has an issue with commitment. To me, that's different than I'm just never going to find love again and I'm just going to sleep with everybody.
That one guy in high school broke my heart, so I'm never trusting another
one. Like I'm going to be a single Pringle fuck for fucking ever.
Oh my God.
Like,
I've had,
no.
Okay, personally in real life, I've had a gazillion boyfriends that, you know, quite a few, like, you know, or total douche nozzles. It did not deter me. I was determined to find my HEA.
I think that like I said, this is extenuating circumstances. This is something that I'm just like, oh, here we go. But you know what? Authors can write a really good story with mm-hmm. this trope. I'm yes. just saying, whenever I hear it, I'm like, okay, now author, you have to convince me that I like it. Yes. Now you have to convince me yes. that I like it. Yeah. That's all I'm saying. Like, it could work, but I feel like the author is going to have to work a little bit harder for me to love it.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I mean, I'm with you on this because now, even like since you and I had this conversation earlier about it, as soon as they say, like, you know, they're a commitment phobe, I'm like, oh, dude, okay, yeah. why?
Commitment phobes, why? I'm a little bit over commitment phobes.
And I just don't believe that there are so many, okay, yes, okay, I guess through college, you like to play around mm-hmm. and play, you know, sow your oats and stuff. But once you kind of exit college, most people become adults, you know, right. and are looking for a partner in life. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And so it just doesn't ring true to me that, you know, all guys want to be players. Also,
like,
you know,
one of the instances where I feel like it's like my pet peeve radar is really exacerbated is the trope of like the player and the virgin, like having yeah. the guy being the absolute player who is never going to settle down because of reasons. And then, of course, the person that catches his eye is this fucking virgin who doesn't even know. You know, never been in a relationship or whatever and just doesn't know anything about it. But that's the person that catches his eye. And I'm just right. like, I'm just kind of tired of that kind yeah. of situation. Yeah. And you know what? Throw me some heroines who are just like, want to just go to Pound Town with everybody. Because that's really not, I haven't read many books where it's actually the heroine that is yeah. like the player.
Yeah.
And like, ooh. You know what? Give me some of those and then maybe I'll be happy.
You know, I've written only one of those and I got so much backlash from
really?
Some of that.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I guess they were like, because they double standards.
A lot of people loved her, but some were like,
oh my
don't
God,
like
I know who you're talking about now.
From Winburn.
I was fucking pissed though, because you took out a scene that I thought was fucking hot, but they made you take it out.
Oh, the office I forgot scene. About that. Yes.
The office scene. I thought it was fucking hot and people were like, fuck no. And yeah. I was like,
wait,
why can't she? Why can't yeah. she be
that's
the one
bad thing that,
to want to hit it and quit it
with Kensington?
Okay, I'm sorry. Now I'm getting mad.
But she still does. Yeah. Yeah.
She is still yeah. that character, but you have to tamp her down a little.
I did.
Man.
Yeah. Because they were saying fun. She was too much of a man eater. And I still got those.
Fuck,
like,
fuck that. Authors, give me some man eaters. I like this. Okay. I like this. Give me that.
I'm listening to you, Jess. Yeah. We'll do that for our duet.
I don't like double standards whenever it comes to heroes and heroines. I think that the heroine deserves a chance to sow her yeah. wild oats and maybe meet a guy who's a virgin. Okay.
Oh my
Give me
God.
That. Give me that.
I'm writing that shit.
Do it.
Right. I am not even kidding you. Where's my fucking notes? Hang on. I'm putting this on my phone right now. Excuse me, guys. Go ahead. Y'all do your
okay,
thing.
Okay. I'm going to move on while she's writing. I'm going to move on to my next pet peeve, mine. Stretching misunderstandings. This one is the type of book that it creates this like epic drama that the entire conflict is based off of this one misunderstanding, but it could be solved in like a snap instant if the characters would just communicate. And I'm talking about in the book, it happens time and time again where one character is about to clear all of the air with one fucking sentence and somebody interrupts them, they get yes. cut off, or the other character yes. says, I don't want to hear yeah. it, and then yeah. walks away. And I'm like, but if you would have just listened,
yeah,
none of this would be a
okay,
problem. And like, I've read a book where this happened multiple times. Like, it was a small misunderstanding that like mm-hmm. drove them apart. And if yeah. they said one fucking
if they just
sentence,
opened
it would have
their mouth.
Oh my God.
Yeah, this one does irritate no the shit out of me. I'm
there
like,
there would have been no book. And I'm just like, I don't like a misunderstanding
right.
being the sole purpose why the characters are not right. together whenever they have ample time to clear that shit up.
And as a writer, when I see this, I'm like, oh my God, this is forced conflict. Come on. What
right.
the fuck?
Very
like,
forced.
You know, and I don't like that. I want it to be feel like real conflict, mm-hmm. you know?
I agree.
Yeah, I get that one. Okay, let's get to the fun one.
Okay, this one's fun. I was telling Juliette about this. So sometimes, and I feel like the more books I read, the more it bothers me, is dicks that are so big that the heroine thinks that it won't fit. And I'm just like, stop it. It's biology. It's going to fucking fit. And if you don't think if you think it's going to be a stretch, there's this thing called lube. Yes. You may use it during yes. sex. It does not mean that you're not aroused. It means yeah. you might still need fucking yeah. lube. It's okay to use lube. Like, okay. why? Why so, is lube anti-sex? Like, no, it's fine.
I am definitely guilty of the big monster dick trope because that is pretty much in most of my books. But not in all of them, but in some, especially the Morgan books, because they're, guys, they're half dragons. They're like yeah. almost 7 feet tall. So they're not going to have wee penis, you yeah. know, so it's going
to
be big.
I'm and not with saying that this has to be a pickle dick. Like, but, I'm not saying that it needs to be.
But she can't be like, oh my God, it's never going to fit. And then it yes. doesn't fit. Well, didn't we see that in Smart Bitches when they were talking about the sex scenes and they were talking about like the bad sex scenes, even though everybody loves Karen Marie Monning. Mm-hmm. There's the one of the Highlander books.
No, that was learning the tropes.
Oh, it was learning the tropes yeah. that talked about it? Uh-huh. Okay, I couldn't remember who was talking about it.
Clayton was the one that said this guy has like, you know, a Pringle can sized dick yes. or whatever, like a schlong. That's like, he's fucking hung like a horse. But
there's this scene, and I thought it was one of the Highlanders with Karen Marie Monning, and he literally is like, I've got to get it in there. And she's like, I'm trying. Yeah. Like, it's like, they're like, literally can't quite get it in.
And it's like, that sounds painful. Guys, I'm not saying that big dicks are bad. I'm not yeah. anti big dick. I'm just saying not all guys have big dicks.
Right.
And it could be a moderate sized dick. It's fine. If he knows how to work it. If he knows how to work it. You know what? Sometimes I don't yes. want a, you know, 12 foot schlong that's just going to stretch you and ruin you for everybody else. Yes. I mean, that just sounds terrible.
In addition to this, one that I hate is when there's like they felt it in their uterus, and I'm like, girl, if you felt that in your uterus, you need to go to the doctor.
Did it get now. Past your cervix?
Like, it's like, holy fucking shit. It just went past the cervix and is in your uterus. Yeah. We have got issues, yeah. man.
There's some interesting, which this is definitely going to be a future minisode, is bad sex scenes. We're going to read some bad sex scenes, definitely. Okay, so another one kind of related to the second, well, not kind of, it's very related to sex.
Yeah, this is one you've talked to me about a lot, which I think is so funny.
This one kills me because I feel like, this is a new trend. Right. Anal is a new trend in romance. Right. I have been seeing it. I saw anal maybe a handful of times about 5 years ago. I maybe saw it like once every like 20 books.
Yeah, and probably mostly in erotica.
Right, exactly. Right. Now it's becoming much more mainstream in mm-hmm. every single book that I read, and I'm here for it. Now, the the reason why I have problems with first-time anal descriptions that are becoming part of like this trend is that most of them, the majority of them, are not realistic at all.
Yeah.
Most of them, it's like, I've never done anal before. Okay, let me stick it in. And I'm just like, no. Oh my God, no.
Let me just get some lube and happen.
No lube. Do you know first time anal scenes I have read in recent romances where there's no, the only lube is her vaginal lube, own lube. No. And then all of a sudden it just fits. And I'm just like, guys, we
need a little bit more.
There is such thing called prep to do it safely and comfortably. Like, mm-hmm. if you don't want it to be enjoyable, fucking go for it. But if you want it to just be enjoyable, can we get some? And the reason why it bothers me is because I know that a lot of people get some education about like that's sex true. Education.
So if they think about this is romance, so if they think this is how it is
and like, oh, I don't need to bring lube. It could just fit and it'll be lovely. Yeah. I'll have an orgasm first time anal. I'm just like, guys, oh my God, we're setting unrealistic standards for people who've never experienced this before. Exactly.
And the problem is it's ruining it, mm-hmm. you know? So
it's for me, because there was a really hot scene we've read. We love this scene, but I was like, I don't understand how she's never done it before, but yet she has the most erotic experience with this monster dick in her ass.
Yes.
No.
Yeah. Yeah.
It just bothers Agreed. Me. I just
she
want,
has to, they have, they can't be an anal
I
virgin.
I'm not talking erotica. I want in regular mainstream romance, sex toys and lube to be normalized. I'm just saying.
And like, realistic.
Please, like, if you, sometimes you need it, okay?
Yeah, and honestly, you know when it doesn't bother me, because I read one recently and I don't even remember what it was, but she was not an anal virgin.
Oh, so yeah, if you've done it before,
you know,
if you want to go in with no prep,
but even so, you still need a little bit of stretch time.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, it does bounce back. So anyway, so my very last pet peeve is just kind of a general thing, and it's copy and paste characters. There's this one particular author that is extremely popular, like very, very, very popular. And so whenever I started reading the romances, I was expecting, like, because I looked at her list of books, and I'm like, oh, she has a ton. And I love whenever I discover a new author and they have a ton of books, because I'm just like, oh, more to read.
Yeah.
Well, I read the first book, and I think the first book that I read, I didn't really like the girl character. And then I read the second book, and I was like, oh, I can get on board with this. I really like this book. I read the third one, and I was like, I'm seeing this trend. This trend that all of, and especially it was in the hero's case in this one particular author, they talk exactly the same. They have the same voice.
Oh.
And like, it's the same, it's the same sounding person.
We've talked about that before.
It's like, literally, if you try to identify these books by quoting what these heroes are saying, I'm telling you, there's no way that you
there's
would be
no
able
discernible
to identify
difference
it because between them. Their speech patterns are the same,
right?
And I just don't like if you can like rinse and repeat a character, and it's just like give you a new name and some new hairstyle, and this is a totally new character. I'm like, but no, it's not though, because they sound and they act exactly like the previous character that you've written. I just don't. That's kind of just a pet peeve, because I'm just like,
it seems
like the authors are just trying to like churn out as many books as they can.
Or they're just not very imaginative or creative.
Maybe not.
And so to me, it just...
And maybe they have a type of man that they really, really, really enjoy.
Right.
And that's what they want to write. I understand that. I understand people having a type, but it's like, I don't know. If you're... Yeah. You got to be kind of diverse in the types of characters that you write, is what
I agree.
Say.
And honestly, that comes down to just character sketching and really sketching out your character. Know how he walks, talks, looks, you know, bad habits. That kind of stuff. I mean, I'm sorry, I'm just like rambling, but I'm just thinking in general, you need to just, you know, character sketch. You know what I was thinking just now, all of a sudden, is that now that we've done pet peeves, we need to do like favorite things that happen in books.
Yeah, that would be cool.
Like our favorite things.
Maybe our favorite 2019 things that happened in books.
Yeah,
like
just like
when
something happened, like, I mean, just things that heroes do that we really love when they do it. You know?
I know what would be on Juliette's favorite thing. Claiming scene.
Shut up.
Yeah. You like possessive males, I would say.
Yeah. I married one. So,
So, another pet peeve is women's fiction being labeled as romance. I don't like that.
Oh, yeah. So that goes back to our misbranding discussion.
Yeah. It is the misbranding discussion for me. And this is the definition of a romance novel, is that the romantic element has to be central to the plot.
Central.
And that if you remove it from the story, it no longer makes sense.
Right.
But if you remove the romance from a women's fiction, there's still a discernible story and still a discernible character arc, because it is actually the heroine's story.
It's her story. Yeah, we talked about that.
Exactly.
You know.
This is a popular book that I absolutely loved. And actually, it was requested by one of our listeners for us to review it. And I just said that we weren't going to review it, that I loved it, but that it wasn't. I don't consider it a romance, because it wasn't the couple's journey. It was a specific character's journey.
Right.
Like, and I 5-starred that book. I thought it was a phenomenal
read. Yeah, I remember you telling
read.
Me that it was just an amazing
A phenomenal
book.
Read. I was like, this had me bawling, crying, and had me laughing. I was like, I was floored after reading this. I was like, but I was disappointed, because I was like, I thought this was an epic romance. And it had its romantic elements. And I was like, but it wasn't. It was this heroine's journey.
Yeah.
I mean, it dealt with some heavy stuff. Mm-hmm. And it's like her overcoming that stuff.
Right. Right.
And the romance was definitely an afterthought. And actually, it was like she didn't even get with the hero until the epilogue. And he was mostly not present in the rest of the novel. And so I was just like, I don't understand why this is labeled romance. This definitely should be clearly marked as women's fiction. But I still enjoy it. But I don't enjoy whenever it's misbranded saying, here's a romance novel. And I'm like, where's the romance?
Yeah. The thing about the
misbranding. I just
want
to know what I'm reading.
Right. I just don't like to feel tricked.
Sometimes
I don't
sometimes
like feel like somebody's trying to pull something over on me.
Like contemporary readers. Contemporary readers. If someone someone said, this is a contemporary novel and gave right. you a paranormal novel, would you not be like, what right. the fuck, dude?
If a vampire jumps out and attacks her, yeah. would you be like, what the fuck?
Exactly. This You'd be like, contemporary. This doesn't make sense. Yeah. Why did you tell me that this was a contemporary whenever it's clearly not?
Yeah.
That's how I feel. And yeah.
Same. I'm 100% there with you.
Yep.
Me okay.
too. Okay. So all that's right. it. That's officially that's it for guys. Our pet peeves.
Yeah.
And we'll be back with some more. We had some great, I just wanted to thank our listeners. We had some really great listener suggestions for future mini-sodes yeah. that you'd like to see. And that was awesome. So if y'all have any more suggestions, just let us know. We'll be happy to do this.
Yeah, these are totally fun.
Yeah, exactly. All right, guys. We'll see you next mini-sode. Bye.
Bye.